Mary-Louise, I'm just going to drop everything in the chat now. Is it okay? Just so it's all there. And then, or you want it to be like a certain time?
Yeah, you can do it now. The only thing that we figured out is that like people that join later can't, they don't see it. So you have to put it more than once.
I'll do it again. But I'll be like, it's there now. We can make an announcement, like agenda, minutes. There's all there now. And then I'll do it again later.
Yep. Welcome, everyone. We'll be getting started fairly soon. Just waiting on some more people to join.
Please type your name, child's name, and email address in the chat for attendance. Everyone who attends this meeting will be entered into a raffle to win a $25 gift card to Food Bazaar. For every friend you bring that has not come to a meeting before, you will receive an extra entry. Let us know if you have referred a friend in the chat. Escriba su nombre, el nombre del niño y la dirección de correo electrónico en el chat para asistir. Todos los que asistan a esta reunión participarán en una rifa para ganar una tarjeta de regalo de 25 para Food Bazaar. Por cada amigo que traigas que no haya venido a una reunión antes, recibirás una entrada adicional. Háganos saber si ha recomendado a un amigo en el chat. Si acaba de unirse a nosotros, tenemos un intérprete de español en una sala separada. Si deseas escuchar esta reunión exclusivamente en español, haga clic en el globo Terraqueo y Selección Español en el menú.
Gracias. Hi, everyone. I put a link to the minutes from last week, from last month's meeting, and also today's agenda is in the chat. And I will post again later if we need it.
We'll just give it a few more minutes to see if any stragglers come. And, you know, as the slide says, please type your name, child's name, and email address in the chat for attendance to be entered into the raffle to win a prize. We'll be doing this a little different next week. So our next month, sorry. You'll be finding out about that in a little bit, but we still need your name and child's name and email address so that we know that you came. You can also find the link to the minutes if you didn't get to review them from last week or last month. Feels like a week ago, I don't know. So if you want to check those out, there's a link in the chat to those. And then you can let us know if you have any issues with them later.
I just posted the link again to the minutes in case anyone can't find it. I think I posted a little bit more clearly this time.
And if you didn't notice, we do have interpretation also if you'd like to listen to the meeting in Spanish. Let us know if you need help doing that.
Just put your name and your child's name in the chat, Jordy Acosta, in the class.
All right, you ready?
Let's go.
Okay, so the meeting will please come to order. We have now met quorum, which requires 6 attendees and 2 executive board members. Welcome and thank you for coming. My name is Tiffany Cortes and I am this year's president. Please be advised that all virtual meetings are being recorded as the meeting record minutes and will be shared via email with parents. The agenda is as follows. At 6 p.m., we had our welcome. At 6:10, reading and approval of minutes. 6:15, amendment of bylaws. 6:20, treasurer's report. Refer raffle with Annie Ross. President's report by me and Patrina Lewis. Fundraising committee update by Betsy Kim. Principal's report by Miss Natalie Perez-Hernandez. At 6:45, we're gonna have the mascot contest winner announced. And at 6:50, communication announcements from Mary-Louise Foss. 6:55 p.m., questions and discussion. And we're gonna have the adjournment right after. The minutes, you're gonna speak that, sorry.
That's fine, whatever. A video recording of February's meeting and written minutes was distributed via email via Ms. Rivera and posted to the school's website on March 1st for the approval of the minutes. A link to these have been placed in the chat also. Can you put that again, Jackie, one more time if you didn't already?
Yeah, I'll do it again.
Okay. Okay.
The agenda for the meeting is also in the chat if anyone needs a copy of it or just wants to see it for them.
Are there any corrections or additions to the minutes?
I don't see any.
If there are no corrections, the minutes stand approved.
Okay.
One moment. And we're gonna do the amendment of the bylaws now, right?
Yes. One second, I'm going to get out of this for a second. So just to give people a backstory, we were so excited to get our fundraising committee going that we did not realize we were supposed to amend our bylaws to say we have a fundraising committee now or that it's approved. So you actually have to vote on it to approve that we add that we have a fundraising committee to our bylaws. So here are our bylaws and the addition is somewhere down here. Here we go. So initially there's a note about standing committees, and standing committees are any of the extra committees other than like the executive board that are part of the PSA. And so I added this note, committees will be organized by the executive board and or membership as needed, because clearly we don't have a membership committee nor a budget committee nor an audit committee right now. These are kind of like included in the template that they give us, and they're kind of the first ones some people choose to instate. There's also audit, and then there's ad hoc, which basically means like a committee that's formed for a specific purpose, like throwing a spring dance or whatever. So the one we're wanting to add is the fundraising committee. So here it states fundraising, the responsibilities of the fundraising committee is to establish the financial needs of the school, define financial goals, and raise funds with those goals in mind. The fundraising committee will be overseen by a chairperson. The chairperson is to be elected by the committee during the first meeting each year via vote. Term of chairperson will follow the terms outlined for the executive board, which is one year and then two terms is the maximum that someone can serve consecutive years. The duties of the chairperson are work with the executive board to define financial goals, lead fundraising committee meetings, prepare agenda for meeting, and oversee and manage fundraising events and activities. We kind of already did all that, but Miss Betsy Kim was elected by the committee, and many of you who are on the committee are here today. So you know that already, but we have to make this official. So now we're going to vote. Is there anything else that needs to be said, Tiffany? The official way? I don't know all the jargon, so.
No, I think we're good. Annie, is that right?
Do we motion? I think I have to motion. One of us has to motion that. I motion that we add the fundraising committee and this information to our bylaws.
And I'll second the motion.
Okay. Is that enough or do we need a third?
And then we ask if anyone has questions. Do you have any questions about the regarding the changes? Check the chat. Okay, a couple more seconds. Alrighty.
All right.
So the motion has passed.
Okay. Well, we're going to, I have a poll. So now we do the poll, right?
Yes.
Okay. I'm launching the poll. So everybody, now you can vote.
I don't know if this matters, but the poll just says for to have a fundraiser for popcorn.
Sorry, that's the wrong one. That's the wrong poll. Sorry, guys. Ending this poll. I don't know how to make the, okay, here we go. Sorry, here's the correct poll. There were two. I was thinking we were doing the other one first. You get to vote on that one later. Spoiler alert. We have to leave it up a minute, right? We have 60 seconds.
Yeah. Yes.
88% voted. I think technically we could probably stop it, but.
I think somebody requested Spanish in the chat for the poll.
Jordi Acosta.
It's in Spanish too.
I think she wants the meeting in Spanish. Just click the globe, no, at the bottom.
Yeah. Click el globo, I think is how you say it. In abajo.
Para español puede hacer un clic en el globo. Hay un globo.
Sí.
En la pantalla.
We did the pool. The pool. I just want the meeting to be in Spanish for my mom.
Okay. Do you see like a glow, a picture of the world, the earth on the bottom of the screen?
Like
you can click on that.
With lines on it. It's a circle with lines. Crisscrossing.
And when you click on that, it will bring you to someone to help you hear the meeting in Spanish.
It'll say you can take Spanish and you just pick it.
Wait. It's because I'm in the iPad and I don't know where is it.
I don't know how to do it on the iPad. It should be the same though. Do you see the menu where it says like, mute and all that stuff?
Yes, it says mute. It says like more and oh, now I got it. It says language.
Yep, there it is. And then just Spanish. Click it and click Spanish.
Spanish, I put mute organ. Can you speak? Yes, I put Spanish, but you're.
Can you hear the interpreter when you put it?
Yes.
Okay, good.
See?
Okay. We're waiting on four votes. Is that the executive committee maybe that hasn't voted yet?
Yeah, that's us.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. Can we end it then?
Yeah. I don't have the option.
Yeah, I know. I'm just asking if you want me to end it. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Oh, yes.
Okay. So by a landslide, yes, 100% votes say that we can have a fundraising committee, and zero said no. So we're very happy. Share results. Here we go.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, it's official. All right, back to business over here.
That's me.
Okay, I am going to. All right.
All right. Good evening, everyone. My name is Annie Russ, and I'm the treasurer. Okay, the referral raffle. So it's going to be a little bit different, as Mary-Louise has stated earlier, for next month. We are going to, the only way you're able to get a entry into the raffle, if you bring someone new. You have to bring someone new that has never been here before. That's the only way that you will receive your entry into the referral raffle. A winner will be drawn each week, like we have been doing prior to the previous meetings. And then we will present the winner at the meeting.
Does everybody understand that? Any questions? For this one, we're still drawing from the names of the people that attended last month. But next month, if you brought somebody this time, then please note that you brought them in the chat so that you can be entered into the raffle. Since people didn't know about this, are we going to hold them to this today or like for next month?
Yeah, I don't think we should. They should be penalized for that.
Yeah. So okay.
Next month we will
start. For next month's drawing, if you came today, you get entered in the drawing, but you get an extra entry if you brought somebody. But then next month, for the following month's drawing, you have to bring a new person or you do not get entered.
And please also put in the chat if you have brought someone today, so you can gain that extra entry.
But for now, I think we can go ahead and do the raffle. I have all the names here in the wheel of names.
Oh, wait, let's make sure that I'm the one for anybody so we could put them.
Well, this is just for last month.
Oh.
Yeah. And we didn't have that many people last month. I don't know if it was because of spring break happening right before or what, but if you came to last month's meeting and you don't see your name here, let us know.
Okay, no one said anything.
No one? Okay.
Going once, going twice. Spin the wheel, Mary-Louise, spin it.
All right, here we go. My favorite part of the day. Woo!
Yay! Is Michelle here? And she is here. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So we'll email you with your gift card.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. All right.
Okay. All right, moving on. So our fund balance as of March 3rd, 2021 was $2,512.93. Our recent expense was the referral raffle gift card for today's meeting, which is $25, and it brings our balance down to $2,512.93. Our proposed expense for next month, April of 2021, is $25 for a referral raffle prize, gift card, and that will bring our balance down to $2,487.93. Okay, so we propose a fundraiser. So we have a motion on the floor to bring a popcorn fundraiser. This fundraiser will be replacing drones that belong to the Torellis family and purchase additional drones. Does someone second the motion?
I second the motion.
Thank you. Motion passed. Does anyone have questions regarding this motion? Okay, so just to go a little bit farther in what the fundraiser is, we're gonna do a popcorn sale using Popping Popcorn Company. And they have a lot of flavors, candies and chocolates of many sorts, and it will be virtual. So you can make your order online and you will receive the items. It will be shipped to your home or any destination that you desire. And you can supply links to your families and friends, and that will also apply where the items will get shipped straight to their homes.
All right, I will relaunch the poll now. You guys had some time to think about it.
Do anyone have any questions? If this is because some of the drones, Mrs. Torella's family requested it back because it was his drone, and we're trying to replace it so the kids will still have those drones to work with in the classroom.
No.
Anyone have questions? No. 2 seconds. All right, we're gonna launch the poll. Thank you.
All right. You get to vote again.
Looks like there's a question about the fundraiser.
What percent of sales goes to the PSA?
It's 50%.
Okay. It's been a minute. We're waiting on 9 more votes. If you could go ahead and get your vote in, we'd appreciate it. Eight more votes. I have a question about when the kids will return to school that are 100% remote. Yes.
Okay, I think we're at 100. No worries, thank you for coming.
That's something that we can address with Ms. Perez-Hernandez when she talks. But as far as I know, I think that if you didn't opt back in November, then you have to wait till the next school year. That's what we've all been told. Of course, I think admin can make exceptions, but we can explore that further when she she has her report. The principal.
There's another question asking how the popcorn fundraiser will be conducted. So it's going to be conducted during a movie night, right?
Yeah, so it's going to be a virtual fundraiser, and then we're going to tag it on to a movie night.
So all sales are online, though. You would just send...
Yes. All sales online, not virtual. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, it's virtual. Same thing. But... it's not just like gonna, it's gonna, they're gonna have a virtual movie night where everyone can have their snacks, but I assume that you'll be selling for like a couple of weeks, right?
Yes. We're gonna give it some time for deliveries to be made to people's homes and everything.
All right, we have 92% of the vote, so I think we can move ahead. 23 say yes.
Thank you. Zero
say no. So people like popcorn, think we can do it.
So we'll be having a popcorn fundraiser to raise funds for the drums and tack it on with a movie night.
Okay.
And this will be happening next month.
Okay. Okay.
All right. So this is exciting. So we stepped into a new platform of receiving dues this year, which is real exciting. We are starting to use PayPal. We already have several parents that had donated their dues, which we are very grateful for. But there are several ways that you can do that. You can do cash with the donation slip if your child is in person, and if your child is not in person or in person, you can use the online platform of the PayPal. We're asking for donations of $5 for your annual dues, but feel free to add more if you like. These funds go towards providing fun events for our community, as well as the school enrichment and these like art/music programs, and it extra technology. So we appreciate your donation and your dues. So again, you can submit your dues cash with the donation slip, or you can do it online via PayPal. And the link, we'll drop it in the chat right now.
Can you do that, Jackie? I have one question, Miss Perez Hernandez or Miss Rivera, if you're on. Did the permission slip go out? I sent it last week, and I haven't seen it in my son's backpack, so I wasn't sure if it actually went out.
The permission slip to.
The donation slip for paying dues. I sent a donation slip with my, you know, when I sent the like newsletter and everything with our minutes and all that stuff on March 1st, I included the slip that was to be printed and backpacked.
That I wouldn't be able to answer. The reason is that I'm working from home. So I don't know if Ms. Nilsa did a school run. I will have to ask Ms. Nilsen. I'll get back to you if she's sending it.
Okay. Is that, should I be including her in emails then?
For the school run, if it's a school run, yes.
What's a school run? What does that mean?
When they print it out and give it to the kids, like the A and B.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I can send it tomorrow to her.
Okay, yeah, or either, because if you send it to me, I will forward it to her. It's no problem. Okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
All right.
And on to the graduation picture refund. Again, if you know any former fifth grade students and their parents, please have them reach out to the PSA 376 at our email, psd76psa@gmail.com. If you are a first grader and you have not received your graduation pictures refund from last year, please contact us at our PSA email. We still have a hefty amount of refunds for the fifth graders, and we would greatly appreciate it if anyone know any of the former fifth grade parents to have them reach out to us so we can give them their refund. Thank you.
And Annie, do you want to go ahead and talk about pictures? Because we are having pictures this year.
Yeah. Right?
We're graduating.
Yes, we're having graduation pictures. We just got the notification from Principal Perez that DOE are allowing graduation pictures. So please stay tuned for those details probably about next month when we come back from break.
And I just want to say for the graduation pictures, it's going to be, since we didn't get to have graduation pictures last year, for the kindergarten students, they're going to be taking their graduation photos this year for the kindergarten students. So it's kindergarten, first grade, and fifth grade. Okay. Awesome. So that's one awesome change. Okay, so... Now it's my report. So we're going to have some upcoming meetings. Our fundraising committee meeting on March 16th. April 9th is our next general meeting. Is this PSA? It's PSA of fundraising.
March 16th is the fundraising committee meeting.
And then April 9th is the PSA. And then June 10th and May 20th is the PSA general meetings. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Okay, so upcoming school closures, March 29th to April 2nd, spring recess, May 13th. School is closed. May 31st, school is closed. Next Monday, we had a date change for our Spring Fling Dance Workout Challenge. So please join us. Miss Rodriguez, the dance teacher, is going to be hosting with us. And also, Jackie, do you want to say our other part of it that we're going to do?
Oh, yeah, we had a parent volunteer. He's going to do another little... dance routine with the kids too. We still have to figure out the exact details, but it should be fun.
Okay, cool. And then on April 28th, we're gonna have a goal session for how to live your best life, a goal setting and wealth building workshop with Annie Ross. May 12th, we're gonna have makers and mocktails with mom, where you learn how to make tasty mocktails and learn and create a DIY gift in honor of Mother's Day.
And just to note, you can find the link to register for the Spring Fling Dance Workout Challenge on the school website. If you go to the school blog, it's on there. And also we'll be sending it out again via email. It's probably already in your email, but we'll send it again just in case.
We also are encouraging everyone to please sign up for your New York City Schools account where you can help your school and district get to 100% of their students linked to their Parents NYC Schools account. For more information, please click on the links that are there. Create an account and then, be logged in with everybody so we can all see all the information and everybody could be connected.
I don't know. And the biggest thing here is once you try to create an account, you'll see it'll ask you for an account creation code, and you do have to get a specific code for your child, and you can get that from the school. Miss Rivera should be able to guide you toward that, so you can just email her or call the school about it. But yeah. if you didn't get one sent home already. They should have sent one in mail, but like if you didn't get it, then you can get it.
This is also where the report card will be. This is where all, you know, having conferences in person is where you would find your child's report card.
And you know you want that report card. Okay.
1 second. So the SLT state testing will occur this year for grades 3 through 5 when we return from spring recess. School pictures will be like as any stated. We will be holding picture day this year, either virtually, in person, or both. Look for a sign up form on April 5th. And we have some upcoming virtual events from the Child Mind Institute School and Community Program. So they're promoting positive behaviors for your child. It's a caregiver support series. Each 60 minute workshop will be available at no cost to NYC DOE families. Please see below for details. Their main ones coming up right now, structuring a home learning environment on March 23rd, managing your kids' screen time on April 7th, motivating your child for remote learning on April 13th, motivating your child for remote learning part 2 on April 21st, improving your relationship with your child on April 27th, and parents calming techniques on May 5th. So please, everyone, join.
My love, come on.
Parents were looking for social emotional.
Babe, look at this. So please. Sorry.
Can you mute people? Okay.
Also, we have some information coming up. I know a lot of parents have been asking about the Gifted and Talented program. So on Thursday, March 18th from 6 to 7, they're going to be having more information given about it so that we know what's the new guidance as per DOE. Tuesday, March 23rd as well, March 25th. So if you have any information, click the links. We also received emails, and there's information right there on the screen if you want to screenshot anything.
We'll also send this whole slideshow out so people can get the information from there too. Okay.
1 second before we move on.
Yeah, I had one thing too. So go ahead, Annie, you could go.
There's a PAC meeting on March 23rd at 5:30. During this meeting, we will be discussing the allocation of the 1% set aside for the family engagement, family resources, access to the NYC school account, and also to share concerns and ideas. Flyers will be sent out shortly. Anything I will else? Also add that to the chat.
Is there anything else? Any? No? Okay. So I have, you didn't put a slide for the SLT, right, Mary-Louise?
Mm-mm.
Okay, so I just want to say, we had an SLT meeting at the emergency meeting a week or two ago. And at this meeting, at the SLT meeting, a motion was made to amend the bylaws. We added the emergency meetings paragraph. The bylaws encourage people with questions related to SLT to reach out to their constituent. And if someone has a question, it must be emailed at least 1 week in advance to the chairperson and receive approval from the members via email consensus. All questions have to be related to SLT and CEP matters. After they suggested the changes, a motion was made to accept the minutes as amended. It was then put to a member vote, and all SLT members present voted in favor of the changes. At that time, the bylaws were ratified. So that's the SLT update. So if anybody has any questions, if you guys ever come on the SLT meetings and you wanna, you know, have your say, you feel like you're not having your voice heard, please either email me or the PSA, and we will definitely relay your messages.
Okay.
And then Betsy, you're going to speak about the fundraising committee update.
Sure. So the fundraising committee update, we had our meeting last month and our next meeting will be March 16th. The meetings are the third Tuesday of each month at 6 p.m., except if there's a break. In that case, we'll meet the fourth Tuesday. So the next meeting is March 16th, which is next week. It'd be great if we could see some new faces as well. We had a good group last time. Our first goal set was to raise $1,000 to eliminate bank fees. And that's coming out of the donations that people are making that Annie talked about on PayPal and through cash donations, et cetera. And so far we've raised $173.28, which is great. But we do need to try to reach our goal of $1,000 so that we don't have to pay fees on our PSA bank account. Some of the fundraisers that we have coming up, Annie talked about the popcorn sale. We'll also be doing a t-shirt sale related to the mascot contest. We have school pictures, and I can't see the other fundraisers. Let me see, in Spanish, we have school pictures, and then we also have a book fair that's been going on. So you should have gotten information, I think, home in your child's backpack or also by email. That one's
different though, Betsy.
Oh, well, I see.
Yeah, so there's the school book fair that's going on, the Scholastic, and we're gonna be doing one closer to summer, so you can stop
and buy your
summer reading list books.
It's
going to be through a local bookstore in Brooklyn.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then we'll find out more about that. I think you said that was going to be starting in May.
End of May, yeah.
Okay. And then we're also going to be doing an end of year raffle. So we're starting to gather donations from local businesses. But if any families have things that they would like to donate or know business owners in the neighborhood that might be able to donate something to the raffle, please get in touch with us, because that would be great to have more donations. And that's all we have going on right now, but we look forward to meeting with you next week for the fundraising committee.
And one other thing is that we are planning to sign up with what's called a fiscal sponsor, who will give us 501c3 status. Like, we can basically piggyback on them. So if you work for a company that might make donations to nonprofits, that you could maybe put in a request for us, they can write that off on their taxes. We'll be sharing more information regarding that once it's all set up, but it should be set up within the next month. So that's a new exciting development. And here's a flyer. And you can go ahead and register using this link down here.
So to answer Zaira's question, what kinds of donations are acceptable? We're looking for any kinds of donations, for example, like a gift card to a local store, you know, that families might be interested in a supermarket, a restaurant, coffee place. One parent was able to secure a donation from a cleaning service. And then I saw something on Facebook today that a chess company that gives chess lessons was offering donations for school fundraisers. So I contacted them. So anything that families would be interested in, either for their kids or for themselves, I think would be a great donation for the auction.
But we do accept other monetary donations just to the PSA that we can also use for technology and, you know, potentially other things later on. I mean, we've all discussed a possibility of bringing in another after-school care program or, you know, even getting some sort of music program or something like that. These are all things that are up in the air, but, you know, if we start raising more money, we can start exploring other things like that. Right now we're still baby stepping, but if you know larger corporations, organizations that donate cash sums, we totally take cash.
Okay, so there's, before the principal's report, I want to say one thing. There's PSA breaking news. So I have been, I and the PSA have been advocating for hot lunches in the school. And my son told me that yesterday they finally got hot lunches in the school. So he was so excited, and to the point where the whole entire class literally clapped for hot lunch. So it was really that big of a deal. So I'm happy to say that we finally have hot lunches. Ms. Perez is going to speak more about it. But from what I was told from Ms. Ramirez, the hot lunches will be approximately 4 out of the 5 days. So good news. So Ms. Perez, if you wanna speak on that, and then you can say your principal's report. Thank you so much.
Sure, good evening, everyone. I hope everyone is doing well. So I guess I'll start with the hot lunches, since Ms. Cortes kind of shared already with everyone that we are having hot lunch, a hot lunch item available to students. Ms. Bobadillo, the school foods manager, who's in charge of the distribution of food at the school, said that their goal is for at least 4 days a week during lunch to provide a hot item to students. It's dependent, so she has a very limited staff, about 3 people on her staff, and they also have to provide food to the community. Unfortunately, they were not able to remove us as a food distribution site for the community because we serve so many meals to our community. About 1,000 meals are served out of our kitchen to the overall larger community as a whole. So we must remain a food distribution site. So that does impact their availability and their ability to be able to provide hot meals to the children. But as of right now, the way she has organized it, they should be able to, if all goes well, provide at least 1 hot item to children 4 days out of the week. So we hope that, you know, everything remains in place so that they are able to continuously be able to provide that. So that was a great win, because I know the children do look forward to that. I also would like to share, I know a lot of parents have reached out to me regarding the upcoming New York State ELA and math exams. We have been informed that this year we will be having a New York State ELA and math exam. We unfortunately have not been given the specifics regarding the exam. However, as I have communicated already to many parents, we have been continuing with instruction all year long. And we planned as though we were having a state assessment. So the children have been receiving instruction that has prepared them for what we have always known the state assessments to look like and reflect. We are hearing that there may be some changes to the state assessment just due to the, just the conditions that we're currently all under, some people being full-time remote from home, some being in person. So there will be some modifications to the exam. Unfortunately, those have not been shared with us yet. So we cannot share them with you at this time, but do know that our students have been engaged in instruction that is preparing them for these assessments. No need to really worry. And also, this year will not count in terms of performance and proficiency. They typically, for the past several years, they have not counted towards promotion entirely. We look at the student holistically across the whole year. We look at how much progress the child has made. The state assessment is never the deciding factor in terms of whether a student is promoted or not. We do also implement a portfolio in the event that a student didn't pass day one of the state assessments. So this year, again, we're going to continue to use that as a determining factor for promotion. Also, participation, I'm hearing, is not going to be a factor in terms of holding schools to participation rates, because they understand that everyone is under different conditions and different parents feel differently about their child sitting through an assessment. And of course we support and we understand how any parent feels about that. And we respect whatever your decision will be for your specific child. But we do want a message that we don't want anyone being anxious because we have been working towards this all year long. If you have any questions regarding the New York State ELA or math exam, please feel free to communicate with your child's teacher or to reach out to any one of our, myself, Ms. Ramirez, or Ms. Haig, any administrator. We're hoping to do a parent workshop for the parents, but unfortunately, like I said, we really have not heard much other than we are having a state assessment and that it is the days that are down on the calendar. Somewhat along those lines, also there have been some changes to the gifted and talented application and submission process. And the sessions that were mentioned earlier by Ms. Cortes are going to shed some light for parents in terms of how that's going to function this year. I strongly recommend that you attend, if you're interested in learning more about the gifted and talented application process, or if you know that you would like to enroll your child in a gifted and talented program, I highly recommend attending one of those sessions as we really have not been given any additional information that I could share with you about this application process. So I will be attending one of those sessions as well so that I too can learn how the process is going to change this year so that I can inform any parents that contact us after that point. But it is going to be very different than in previous years because there will not be the administration of an exam. That much we do know. The exam will not be given this school year, and there will be a different approach to the admissions process. So I, again, strongly recommend that even if you're somewhat considering it, that you attend the session and that you're informed so that you know how to go about the application process. I also want to share that we have added a tab to the school website. It's called the Tech Help tab. Our school has what's called a SPOC team. Every school has what's called a SPOC lead, which is an individual in the school building that assists with technology and IT support within the school building. At our school, we have an entire team due to the needs, right, for supporting our families with technology during our current status. The SPOC lead on the team is Mr. Islas, and the communication team members also comprised on that team with Ms. Badillo and Mr. Smith as well. And the role of the SPOC team, and in particular, Mr. Islas, who's the SPOC lead, is really to provide technical support for families. So if you're having any issues with a DOE-issued device, whether it is a DOE iPad or a school-loaned laptop, you can contact our school and one of the communication team members will schedule an appointment for you to meet with Mr. Islas or for you to bring your device to the school and Mr. Islas can look at it and see if he can repair it for you. I know that there is a DOE number and an IT team through the Department of Education that can assist with technical difficulties, but they're often very difficult to contact and it's
Did she freeze?
Yeah, she froze.
Ms. Perez, if you're out there, you're frozen. She's like just frozen in time there. I wonder, I hope she knows.
Can we show the mascot video and then come back to her or no? Is that very long?
Yeah, I think we can do that. So hopefully maybe she'll have to leave and come back. But yes, so finally our, it looks like she left. So maybe she's trying to come back in.
Yeah, I would say just give it like a minute or two.
Yeah.
One pause.
Okay. If anyone has any questions for her also, you could go ahead and type them in chat. We will take more questions later, but.
Angie, no, there hasn't been, we're still talking about that. We've been having conversations back and forth with Ms. Perez in regards to guidance about the graduation ceremonies, but no, not yet. I've also asked the superintendent about that as well. So she's aware and they're trying to make something happen, even if it's outside of the school, like, cause you know how they close off the streets for gym and stuff like that. So I also brought that to their attention. So hopefully, you know, they'll make something happen. And they're also going to be doing, if they do graduation ceremonies, it would be a step up for kindergarten. It would be one for first grade since they didn't have anything last year, and then for fifth grade. So they're still trying to figure that out. We'll look into that, Jennifer. Thank you so much. Did Ms. Perez come back yet or no?
No.
So if you, I mean, I guess show the mascot video and then if she comes back, we'll just go and join her.
Okay. Yes, so the kids did vote on the mascot. The IT team chose 12 finalists. I think it was 2 per grade. And then the kids voted. The person with the most votes became the grand prize winner. And then the runner up was the top from the lower grades, which it was kind of like there was votes for the top for, but I'm not saying this very clearly. Okay. There were 2 top winners. One from K through second and one from third through fifth. Whoever had the most votes overall became the grand prize winner, and whichever one of those 2 had the next most votes for their group became the second prize winner. So here is a video of all of the finalists. Oh, there's Ms. Perez. She's back. Do you want to do the mascot video real quick and then you can finish? Okay. She says, yes, you were frozen in outer space. okay, sharing. Escape. All right, mascot contest. Here we go. We're not having good luck in the internet world today. I don't know what's going on here. All right, I'm gonna just try to reload it. I was just getting into the song. Okay. It's not letting me fast forward. I had you to myself, walked you around. I don't know who made the video, Miss Perez-Hernandez, who made the video that we want to give them their credit.
Yes, that was Miss Velasquez.
Oh. So Miss Velasquez put together this cute video. So Steam the Star is our official mascot. So we'll be working with Tara and kind of sculpting it into a little bit more polished look, and it'll be on the t-shirt. And also the second runner-up will also get their design on the t-shirt, and all of our finalists will receive a certificate for their being semi-finalists. And we're also planning on displaying their work somewhere in the school, I believe is the plan. But we had so many awesome entries, so we thank all the kids who entered. Okay, back to business though, now that we got Miss Perez back.
Back to the principal's report.
Yes.
Yes, sorry about that. How fitting to be right in the middle of talking about technology. Yes, so Mr. Isas, like I said, is the lead. In addition to having any issues or communicating any issues regarding technical assistance and device issues to the SPOT team, you can also contact us if you need any support with understanding or learning how to navigate any of the apps on the equipment, or any type of a technology question that you may have. We're here to support. So the tab for the SPOC team is on the school website, and it's titled Tech Help, and all the information will be there. We are uploading it, so it should be up by tomorrow. So please feel free to peruse and to contact us if you have any questions. That's also true of any matter that you may have a question about. Please feel free to call the school or any member on the communication team so that we can address any questions that you may have. I do know that I was also asked to share some information regarding the grant submissions that we have made to our local politicians. So I do want to just share with you the titles of those grants. For Borough President Eric Adams, we submitted a technology grant proposal. And what we did was, since his application process did not allow us to technically upload multiple proposals, we grouped multiple proposals under one technology umbrella. So the technology grant that we put in for included a proposal for a laptop upgrade, a proposal for a media center modernization, a proposal for a computer lab modernization, a proposal for an iPad upgrade, and a proposal for modernization of our environmental design lab. And that is really to work with the company New York Sunworks. Then Councilwoman Dharma Diaz, who is new, we submitted a grant for the New York Sunworks in the amount of $9,000. So those are the two proposals that we have out to our local politicians. So anyone that, you know, may want to contact them and let them know that we have submitted these proposals as parents of our school, that's the information so that you know what the grants were under that we submitted. Okay. Okay, and I also just wanted to share that coming next week on the school website will be a highlights video of our fabulous Torellis steam night that we had end of February. I think it was February 25th. It was a great event. It definitely was a wonderful presentation, and the sessions were very much enjoyed. We do know that some parents, because some of the sessions did have a cap on them, not everyone that wanted to get into these sessions was able to. So what we are also going to do, in addition to loading or posting the highlights video on the school website, is we're also going to post a link to the full video for each one of those sessions, so that you could participate with them at your leisure with your child, if you were interested in any of the other sessions that you did not get to attend. So that will be on the website next week. And since we are talking about STEAM related events, I will mention that we will be having an upcoming parent meeting regarding the STEAM Expo to provide you with all information related to our STEAM Expo that will take place later on in the spring, more likely June, so that we'll be sharing the criteria, the process, the timeline, with you during that time. And it is going to be on March 25th before we go off on break. So if you're interested in learning any information regarding the STEAM Expo, please feel free to join us that evening at 5 p.m. It will be facilitated by two of our instructional technology committee members. And we will be, after we do our presentation and share all of the information related to the upcoming STEAM Expo with you, we will take parent Q&As if you have any questions about the material that has been presented. So that is my principal's report. It was a little bit more in depth than usual, but I will now turn it back over to the PSA. I hope everyone has a wonderful evening. If you don't have questions, if you have questions, I'm more than happy to answer any questions you may have.
Yeah, I think we can go ahead and just do questions because we're running out of time anyway. So I'm going to take the interpreter out of the interpreter room so we can just kind of do it all at once, in case there are some questions in Spanish that everyone else would like to hear. One second.
Ms. Perez, Angie had asked in the chat about the graduation. Is there any new guidance regarding the ceremonies or anything like that? Because I briefly updated her, but if you have anything else, please.
Graduation. Yeah.
So the latest update is that they have approved outdoor ceremonies, I believe. And there has to be a virtual option for parents that do not want to attend an in-person event. We're awaiting further guidance in terms of like if there are capacity limits or how that's going to happen. But as of right now is what has last come down over the last few days, is that there is an opportunity for an outdoor ceremony. They have not expanded that to an indoor graduation ceremony, but so far they are saying that we may be allowed to do, that we are allowed to do an outdoor ceremony, but we're just waiting for their details to know exactly if we'll meet whatever the capacity limits are for it, and even an outdoor ceremony. So we'll continue to talk about this as we get further details.
Ms. Perez, I was wondering, you mentioned the math and ELA exams. I was wondering if they're going to do a science exam for fourth grade this year, a state one.
So all the exams are back on the calendar. That okay. includes the science exam, as well as the NYSA SLAT exam. So we'll be in full exam mode for the rest of the
year. Even though the science has the hands-on portion. They haven't told us how. Yeah.
That is a big question, and okay. we have not received any detail up to this point. Believe me, as soon as we hear anything, we will have an emergency parent meeting so that we can relay all that information to our parents in the third, fourth, and fifth grades.
Okay, thank you.
Before any more questions, one second, I'm just going to close out the interpreter room so she can come join us in the in this room.
Ellos van a cerrar la,
there she is.
El espacio del español.
Hi, Erica. Can you, you're in the main room now. So
hi, okay.
Doing questions. We'll just kind of go back and forth. So did you get to give everyone an overview of what just was said a few minutes ago?
About I tried my best.
Okay. I know it's a lot. I know it's a lot. Okay. Someone also asked, is there an update on adding more kids to the 5-day schedule the school year? I know the answer to this, but Ms. Perez, do you want to share? I think she's talking about full day.
So we have 5 days in person a week. Yes. So we have transitioned every class that we possibly could do 5 days in person for have already been transitioned to 5 days. So at this point, we have 233 children that are in person, and due to capacity limitations, or because some teachers are servicing more than one learning program, we don't have any classes, other classes at this time that can be transitioned to 5 days of in-person. What we are able to do on a case-by-case basis, I know a parent did ask about the opt-in period, and if they could still opt their child into blended or 5 days of in-person. It's really on a case-by-case basis because of those capacity limits. In many of the classes, we've reached full capacity. We still have a few classes that have one or two seats available. So if you would like your child to come back to in-person from a full-time remote setting, please call the school so that we can verify if there's a seat available on that grade level. And if there is, then we will reach out to the district for approval. And they have been working with us to approve those requests where they can be approved. So if we have the seat, you will more than likely be able to be transitioned back to in-person learning. It's just, unfortunately, we don't have many seats available across the grades. We wish we did, but you know, we do have to adhere still to the mandated CDC and DOH capacity guidelines.
Can you say that in Spanish too?
So alguien se preguntó si que pueden hacer más clases en 5 días cada semana, pero ahora ellos no pueden hacerlo porque no tienen apoyo de los tutores y también administradores para administrar la escuela seguridad. Entonces, todos los estudiantes que son solo remoto, es posibilidad que pueden cambiar a blended learning para ser aprendiendo de persona, pero la escuela solo tienen pocos sillas. Entonces, si que quiere hacerlo, necesita contactar la directora o también la señora Rivera.
All right. Someone asked, and this is from the Spanish line, I think, the person would like to opt their child out of the exam, and they want to know how they can do that.
Anyone who has made the decision that they would like to opt their child out of the exam has to write a letter to myself, to Ms. Ramirez, to Ms. Haig, requesting that your child be opted out. And it has to say the New York State ELA math and science exam, if you're wishing to opt them out of all exams, or if you're only looking to opt out of one particular exam, you have to be specific in naming the exact exams that you would like your child opted out of. But without that written letter, even with a verbal conversation, we are unable to fulfill that unless we have a letter from the parent signed.
Can you tell me the two exams again? It's
Oh, sure. The exams that are on the table are the New York State ELA, the New York State math exam.
What is and ELA? The New York English language.
ELA, English language arts. So that's the reading exam.
Okay.
The math exam and the science exam.
Okay. Si que no quiere su estudiante a participar en los exámenes del estado de Nueva York, es muy importante que necesite escribir una carta a la directora a escribir específicamente los exámenes que no quieren su estudiante a hacer. Entonces, sí que no quiere hacer el los artes de la idioma inglés, el ELA, examen ELA, necesita hacerlo específicamente. Si que no quiere hacer el examen de matemáticas, también hay un examen de las ciencias. And there's one more.
Science. Oh, the NICESLAT exam. Yes, and NICESLAT, which is for English language learners.
Okay, hay también un examen para los estudiantes aprendiendo inglés ahora. Entonces, sí que no quiere hacer, no quiere su estudiante hacer los exámenes, necesita escribir un correo electrónico a la directora y que necesita ayuda. Puede llamar la escuela, puede escribir la señora Rivera o también la directora y ellos pueden hacer pueden ayudarse a hacer la carta.
I have a question. So we were notified that there were 3 recent cases of COVID at the school, but we did not close the school. So why was that? A lot of people seem to have questions like, what's the, when does it close? And, you know, what are the so protocols there?
La secretaria preguntó por qué no recibimos carta que dijo que la escuela estaba cerrada, porque recibimos 3 notificaciones de estaba 3 casos diferentes de COVID.
So as everyone knows, I cannot say too much about individual cases due to FERPA, but what I can say is that all determinations about whether a school goes into a classroom closure, a building closure, a 24-hour building closure, or a 10-day building closure, or if there are no closures, is made by the situation room. So the situation room determines if they investigate and they determine if the cases that are reported are linked in any way. And it's when you have unlinked cases that spark closures, right? So usually you'll get that stipulation in the letter that says, oh, your school had 2 or more unlinked cases. Therefore, there's either a 24-hour or a 10-day building closure. So the determination must have been made by the situation room that these were linked cases. And that is why we're not in a closure, because if they're linked, I guess they consider their investigation completed. All close contacts are notified and are told to quarantine for 10 days. And typically, if there are multiple linked cases in a room or even one linked one case in a room, the classroom is closed and the classroom then moves to full-time remote learning. So that was the determination by the situation room.
El cuarto del situación decidieron si el equipo van a cerrar o no. Y es dependiente si que los casos son conectadas o no. A veces es solo es en un clase, entonces la escuela van a cerrar la clase. La directora no pueden hablar de los casos específicamente o individuales, pero los casos en la semana pasada no estaban conectados. Esa es la razón que el equipo está abierta.
So I have a quick question about the exams. I just wanted to know, so if the parents are able to opt out, does it mean that these tests are not mandatory? And also, what are the exams used for, and they're like, what's their purpose?
Mm-hmm. So the exams, for several years now, parents have had the option of opting out of the exams. Typically, schools are given a participation rate and a participation grade, and that can affect funding for the school if not enough of your student body participated in taking the exam. This year, that's the piece that also has been waived, but it's always up to the parents to make the decision as to whether or not they want their child to sit for an New York State ELA or math exam. The exams are really given just to show the school and the community where the children are in relation to the state standards. And then we utilize that information to group children for small group instruction. We also use that to make adjustments to our curricula and instructional plans. They're never used as a sole determination in promotional decisions, right? It can be a piece of the puzzle in terms of whether or not a child is gonna be promoted, but it's never the sole factor. It was many years ago, where if you did not pass day one of the state exam, you had to come to summer school. And then if you didn't pass the summer exam or the summer portfolio, then you could not be promoted to the following grade. But for many years now, that has not been that has not been the case. And we look at the child, like I said, holistically, and we look at the amount of growth the child has made across the year, the progress they're making, and we make the determination that way. We do give students sometimes a student portfolio, but it's comprised of pieces that the student has engaged in across the school year, some samples of writing, some running records, some math inventory, to see if the child is approaching the standards or if they're far behind the standards. And that information is more used to decide whether a student should be promoted or not. The state assessments are really just a piece of or a snapshot of the student's performance in comparison to the state standards. It tells us their proficiency if they're in the fourth and fifth grade. It could also tell us the amount, it does tell us the amount of progress that the child has made from one year to the next. And that's important to know, right? Because we're always trying to ensure that the children are growing and progressing. And we want to ensure that they're making that year's progress from year to year. So it's really just to help us have another understanding or another piece of evidence to help us understand how the child is doing academically in ELA and math.
Thank you. Erica, do you want to translate?
ella se preguntó si que los estudiantes no necesitan hacer el examen, que es el punto, porque ellos van a hacerlo. Y la directora dijo que es importante a cesar su estudiante que se encontraron las líneas del aprendiendo. That's a really poor translation, but I got it more or less. If anybody else speaks Spanish, you can give it a try.
Erica, would you like some help?
Yeah, go ahead. I've been doing this all night and I'm so toast.
Okay, you've done a great job.
Hi, this is Michelle Sanchez. Básicamente, damas y caballeros, los exámenes estatales se utilizan para poder accesar cómo los niños están funcionando de un año al otro. La data que se colecta cada año es específicamente también para que los maestros y la escuela pueda planificar y pueda ayudar a sus hijos poder hacer progreso académicamente, porque cuando se está planificando para la instrucción, los maestros utilizan la data, utilizan cómo los niños están haciendo para poder planificar. En el pasado, la escuela ha utilizado diferentes formas para poder accesar los niños, los portafolios y el trabajo auténtico que hacen sus hijos. También cuando están mirando que los niños están tomando los exámenes, todo viene a través de fondos. So, dependiendo el porcentaje de estudiantes que sí toman el examen, cada escuela recibe un tipo de fondo por el estado. Este año no lo van a usar contra las escuelas. No van a usar los resultados contra los estudiantes tampoco. So lo que están mirando es saber cómo están siendo sus hijos, y la señora Perez, la directora, ha dicho que a través del año escolar completo se ha seguido el aprendizaje como si los niños estuvieran en la escuela. So uno no debe de tener, no debemos de tener temor para nuestros hijos, porque es para ayudarlos y también para ayudar a la escuela poder planificar para sus hijos y seguir ayudándolos a ellos a hacer progreso académicamente y para que puedan tener éxito, porque esa es la única manera que nos podemos ayudar a todos.
Thank you. I see that there's another question in the chat regarding from Ms. Johnston. Can kids in general ed K through 4 request an interview to see if they can get acceptance to transition to the GNT program, since we have such small classes in GNT. I'm going to attend the sessions that Ms. Cortes shared earlier to see what the application process is going to be for next year. Of course, whatever that is, that then means that any student in our school would be eligible to apply to be in a GNT class. And yes, we do have seats in all of our GNT classes, as they are somewhat small. So anyone who is considering that option for their child, I recommend that you definitely attend one of those sessions so that we are all aware of what the application submission guidance is going to be for this school year. And we ensure that, you know, if there are any deadlines, everyone gets those applications in before the deadlines, because we want to be equitable. We want to make sure everyone has access. And if that's something that someone wants, an opportunity they want for their child, then by all means, we want to make sure that every parent has access to that. So we'll continue to communicate any information that we continue to learn about the GNT enrollment process as we go forth and as we learn more details. And someone is asking if the application is open to all grades. It should be open to all grades K through 4. I'm not sure what the process is going to be for grade 5, being that they're moving on to middle school, but that's definitely something that I will keep my ear open for during the upcoming city sessions. And we'll share that as well.
I'll try to keep helping Erica since I was pulled in 3 different directions. La directora estaba hablando, la pregunta tenía que ver con si los estudiantes pueden participar en una entrevista para esos que están interesados en aplicar para el programa de estudiantes de honor y talento. Ahora lo que sucede es que todavía están haciendo nuevas, los requisitos son un poco diferentes. La directora va a asistir a unas reuniones de información para poder tener más información sobre el proceso y el sistema de aplicación para los niños. La aplicación debe de estar abierta para los niños de kinder, el jardín infantil hasta cuarto grado. Los niños que están en quinto van a entrar a la escuela intermedia, eso puede ser un poco diferente. El propósito de la escuela, de la directora, es sí participar en estas sesiones informativas y mantener a ustedes, a todos nosotros, informados con los cambios, con el proceso de las aplicaciones y todo que se va a requerir para ustedes aplicar para sus hijos y abogar para sus hijos, tener las fechas de cuándo las aplicaciones tienen que ser sometidas para que todo esté al día y ustedes puedan hacer la mejor decisión para ellos. Si el niño, si ustedes quieren aplicar para estos programas, es importante que todos tengan la oportunidad. Nadie debe de sentirse que no tuvo la oportunidad de poder aplicar para un programa si es lo que quiere.
And I do also want to note, though, that the application process is already open. So if you're a parent and you know for sure that you want your child to be a part of the GNT program, if you go onto the schools.nyc.gov site, the application is already accessible. And like I said, we'll definitely share more information as we get it.
El proceso ya, las aplicaciones ya están en vivo. Se pueden conseguir en la página cibernética de las escuelas, escuelasschools.ny@gov, right? Yeah. Ajá. Ya las aplicaciones están en vivo y pueden aplicar a este momento.
And it is very true. In the past, there was the gifted and talented exam was only administered to students in K to two. However, there were means for children in grades 3 through 5 to be included in a GNT program. The guidelines were that they had to receive a level 4 on both the ELA and math state assessment. You could then be placed in a gifted and talented program at the school level. I do not know what those stipulations are going to be this year with all of the changes. And that's why I feel like it's very important that anyone that has any questions about GNT attend those sessions. And then we can talk about it afterwards in another parent meeting.
Es verdad que en el pasado los padres que estaban interesados de aplicar para el programa para sus hijos, los niños de kinder a segundo grado tenían que tomar una evaluación. Y también ya los padres que querían, había otro proceso para los niños de tercer y cuarto grado, que si había cupo y los estaban interesados en el programa, podían aplicar y eran considerados si tenían un nivel, I'm sorry, you said 3 and 4, right?
No, level 4 in both ELA and math.
Tenían que tener un nivel 4 en ambos exámenes estatales de matemática y de artes del lenguaje en inglés para poder ser considerados y puestos en ese programa. Por los cambios, por la pandemia, han habido tantos cambios que están dando estas sesiones de orientación y la directora sí le da la sugerencia que si pueden asistir, que asisten, porque no sabemos todos los cambios y cómo va a afectar el proceso de las aplicaciones en este programa.
Any more questions? No, it's getting late for everyone. If you do have more questions, you can always email the PSA at ps376psa@gmail.com and we can get your answers for you. Or you know, you can always call the school. I know everyone's very, or contact Ms. Rivera. You know, everyone's very open to fielding your questions in any way that they can. So please get in touch. I'm sure people want to be putting their kids to bed soon. So I think we can probably wrap up fairly soon, unless there's something pressing.
Nope. So if there is no further business, the meeting will stand adjourned. Thank you everyone for joining us. Have a good night.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Good night. Thank you. Thank you for translating to. We were special tonight. We had two.
No problem.
Michelle, do we have you on the hook for next week, next month?
I try to make it in on time. So if I make it in on time.
Okay. All right. All right.
Thank you. And thank you, Erica. We appreciate it. You did a wonderful job. Thank you so much.
I think she left already. She had to go. So I'm glad Michelle was here.
That's great.